the 19th chapter. Now that's in the New Testament scripture here. It'll be about the 5th book in the New Testament scripture.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
The book of Acts. The 19th chapter of the book of Acts. And I'm going to begin reading at verse number 1.
Amen. Amen.
And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus and finding certain disciples, he said unto them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And they said unto him, we have not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. And he said unto them, unto what then were ye baptized? And they said, unto John's baptism. And then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. And when they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them. And they spake with tongues and prophesied. And all the men were about 12. Praise the Lord. From these verses, I want to talk about an incomplete assignment.
All right, man.
An incomplete assignment.
Yeah.
Those of you that can hear my voice.
Yeah.
And understand my words.
Yeah,
have all been to school and obtained one grade level or another. And we are familiar with the steps, the stages, and the grades.
Yeah.
How that if you got a certain grade at the end of the school term, then you are promoted to the next grade level at that time. And we understand that grades are very important. At least they used to be, I don't know. But grades were how supposedly folk could determine what level you were on in your learning and understanding. And our system, we have grades A through F. You understand that. A, of course, being the best grade, and F being the worst. And generally speaking, those grades are determined based on how well you satisfy the teacher for whatever your given assignments were. But that was a grade that some folk received during the term. That perhaps when they got it was somewhat of a neutral grade. Y'all ain't saying that. You understand, sometimes the teacher would give an assignment and it had a level of significance that was of high or medium sort. And if you did not complete the assignment, they would give you an I instead of an A, B, C, D, or F. And an incompletion in school is not always a bad thing, at least not in the outset. Amen. So sometimes if it's the beginning of the school term and you don't turn in an assignment and you get it incomplete, that's not going to really hurt you as long as you can change it from an incomplete to a grade before the end of the term. Amen. Some of us, it's something about incompletions in your grade. You have a mind of the fact that this is something I must get done.
Yeah, amen. Right, so amen.
The incompletion is designed to show you or to remind you that there's still something that you have to do.
Yeah.
Some of us as believers, when we look at it from the spiritual standpoint, some of us got some incompletions.
Amen.
That's weird about an incompletion in school. You can have all A's on everything you've done and turned in, but an incompletion, if it's not completed before the turn ends, that becomes a zero. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I don't care how high your average was, when you factor in a zero, it's bound to come down.
Amen.
You understand that?
Yeah.
You know, just messed it up and got a 56. A 56 can go with some stuff and do pretty good. You understand? But a zero can't pull you all the way down. And now sometime in the class you can have done some other stuff and even got extra credit. You understand? But the extra credit becomes irrelevant when you have incompletion. That becomes zero. So in other words, it's like, I appreciate your effort. You did a good job. I like how you did extra. You did extra voluntarily, and you didn't do that which you were assigned. And some of us with God, we're doing everything but what God told us to do. And we're thinking that's going to give us a good impression with God. We're thinking that's going to make God allow us to come into glory anyhow. Y'all ain't saying that. But the end of that way is destruction. Some will think that they don't want to have to get to know God for themselves. As long as they throw some money at the church. As long as they help some homeless folks. As long as they be nice to one or two folks. Y'all ain't saying that. God never charged us with picking us on special projects. He never charged us with finding somebody who we got a soft heart for. Your heart got to be soft for everybody. Y'all ain't saying that. God is no respecter of persons. When you find for dying for God, that's for you.
Yeah.
That's
it.
Amen.
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 When you do stuff for people, just to be seen. You understand that you're not even considering their real needs. You're doing it for your ego. So somebody will pat you on the back. And yet God requires us to love one another. And even when we do good deeds, they're not done in love. In some kind of way, wind up to always be about me, myself, and I.
All right.
So some folk don't care what good they did for somebody else. And when they tell the story, it's all about making them look good. Amen. You can go to a ball game and they played one inning. Y'all ain't saying that. Jump up to my, we won. You know, you jump up to my, they won because you was yelling because you told the man to steal base. You know, you know, we got a way to make everything be all about us.
Amen.
In our text, Y'all go ahead and put your amens, because I'm going to be shocked. Don't hold it.
Amen.
In our text, the Bible said that the Apostle Paul, passed through the coast of Ephesus.
Uh-huh.
And there he ran upon 12 disciples.
Uh-huh.
Not the 12 disciples that we're familiar with.
Right, right.
Not Peter, James, and John, and Matthew and them. These were disciples of John.
Uh-huh.
And note that John had disciples before Jesus started his ministry, his earthly ministry, and there were those who followed John, and the scripture said that John had told them plainly, I'm not the one, one is going to come after me. John plainly said, I'll baptize you with water. One coming after me that's going to baptize you with fire and the Holy Ghost. Understand. I hear folks singing this song about they went in that water and they come up and their hands look new. You still got the same rest of hands you had when you went in the water. Come on, talk about that feet were new. If you were pigeon-toed going in the water, you pigeon-toed coming out of the water. But what God wants to make brand new is our heart, and the water itself does not do that, but the fire does.
Alright. Amen.
And that's even when folk would even get baptized.
That's right.
Nowadays, we have surrogates. You know what I'm saying? When they feel the presence of God and hear the voice of God, instead of getting up saying, I want to be baptized, they send little Johnny up there.
Yeah.
Amen.
Come on.
I was in revival the other night, they opened the doors of the church and a little boy came up to be baptized.
Yeah.
I just couldn't. I didn't want to be out of order, but I really wanted to know who had sent him up there. Amen. Some of us, there are some things you can get your kids to do for you. You know, you can send them to the store. Mama used to send us to the store. You know, go up there, the white flag or the coats or the beacon or something. You understand that? And bring back whatever it was she wanted. Some of us, I really believe, think that if we hear the word of God concerning baptism, since we don't like water like that, y'all ain't saying that. We tend to think that we'll just send the children up there. When the children get baptized, we've done something. Problem with that is when the child come up at 8 or 9 years old for baptism and didn't understand what baptism meant. Then when he gets 40 and hears the true word of God and needs to be baptized, and now when he come join the church, they ask, have you been baptized? He gladly says, yes, I've been baptized. I got baptized when I liked it, the water. Y'all ain't said that. But I didn't mind playing in the water. Y'all ain't said that. And now it's time that God will come and symbolically wash away all of your sin. And all of a sudden, you're allergic to water. We think it's just something for children. But I know that it's necessary.
Yes.
Because the Bible said that John the Baptist was baptizing at the River of Jordan.
Yeah.
And along came Jesus.
Yeah.
And John's introduction, he said, behold, the Lamb of God. That takes away the sin of the world.
Yeah.
And the Bible said, Jesus said to John, baptize me now.
Uh-huh.
And John said, I need to be baptized by you.
Yeah.
And you coming to me to be baptized. Yeah. Jesus' response, I think you ought to hear, he said, suffer it or allow it to be so that all righteousness can be fulfilled. And if Jesus, who was already holy, if Jesus, who was already righteous, if Jesus, who had done no sin, was baptized, how do you think you good enough to not need to be baptized?
All right. Amen. Amen.
He said, all righteousness.
Yeah.
might be fulfilled.
My Lord.
Amen.
But there are folk who have been baptized as adults.
Yeah, amen.
When they were baptized, certainly they had a feeling that urged them to get baptized.
Yes.
But many folk, I'm afraid, get baptized and they stop right there. And then we have this boast that simply says, you understand, I know I'm a Christian because I believe in Jesus and I confess my sin and I was baptized. Now, I don't know who told you that makes you a Christian.
Right.
Father Book said they were first called Christians at Antioch.
Yeah.
They were not called Christians because they had been baptized.
All right.
They were not called Christians because they went to church all the time. They were not called Christian because they abided by certain rules, but they were called Christians because they were of Christ. The Christian comes from the word Christ. They were followers of Christ and they were like Christ, so then they were called Christians. That's never really been the goal. Y'all ain't said the goal has never been to be called Christian, because that's something that is subjective. That's something that folk have a tendency to think that they can measure. So when they see you in certain places, they'll just say, you ain't no Christian.
All right.
If they see you do certain things.
That's right, that's right.
They'll declare that you're not a Christian.
Amen.
Our problem with what God has called us to do is that we always want something that man can measure. You understand that? And I told you we go around like it's a sin meter somewhere. If you do a certain amount of sin, you're not saved. If you do this, you're not saved. If you do that, you're not saved. And the reality is what God wants us to do is receive his spirit. In our hearts. A lot of folks don't like to talk about spirit, but the truth of the matter is the breath that you breathe is a spirit. Did you hear what I said? The breath that you breathe, that's your spirit. And you may not ever want to talk about it, but I don't think you want to get without it.
All right.
Did you hear what I said? The breath that you breathe, according to the word, that's referred to as a spirit. And besides the breath that we breathe, there are many other spirits. And the greatest, the strongest, the most effective spirit I know of is the Holy Spirit. Because when you have the Holy Spirit, it will prevent other spirits from coming in and taking over your soul. Y'all better get this. The Holy Spirit itself, that's the keeper, that's the leader, that's the guide. That in the book says he'll lead you and guide you into all truth. The rabbi declared that it is the comfort. It's the thing that Jesus promised his disciples.
Amen.
Amen.
After having been with Jesus for 3.5 years, and Jesus knowing he was getting ready to return back to the Father. Tell his disciples, I'm not going to leave you comfortless.
Amen.
But I'm going to send you a comforter.
Glory.
Which is the Holy Ghost.
Yes. Amen.
Which will lead you and to guide you into all truth.
Yes.
And you understand something. If John the Baptist says that I baptize you with water, but somebody coming after me got another way to baptize. You understand that he'll baptize you with fire and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The Holy Ghost is the Spirit of God. And otherwise, when man, the Bible said, God breathed the breath of life in man in the beginning of time. Man became then a living soul. But the Bible said that sin caused man to die. Y'all understand?
Right.
So then the book says when Nicodemus tried to approach Jesus at night and telling him, I know you got to come from God. Can't nobody do these kind of miracles that you're doing. The Bible said that Jesus cut through the chase and simply said, Nicodemus, marvel not that I said unto you, but you got to be born again. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now listen, this word see does not mean you cannot get to look at it. It really doesn't matter whether you get to look at it or not. Looking at the promised land is what Moses was able to do, but he wasn't able to go in. So it wouldn't really do you a lot of good to look at the kingdom of God. When he says, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. He's talking now about comprehension. He cannot understand the kingdom of God. And that's why some folk can't understand nothing that go on in church. When folk are criticizing the church, they can't even defend it. When folks are criticizing the gospel that you believe in, you can't even defend it because you don't know the power that you have.
Amen. Amen.
On Facebook, somebody keeps tagging me in a message where they were arguing with somebody who's running for politics and talking about removing the big cross from Bayview Park, I believe it is. And she was assuring the lady that most minorities who vote were not going to vote for her because she was an acknowledged atheist. And that she was in agreement with them moving the cross. I'm just going to tell you, I don't know how long the cross has been at Bayview Park. But I got sense enough to know that it's not the cross that we cling to. Y'all understand? And you can fuss about them moving the cross from Bayview Park, but if you had the cross in your heart, you wouldn't have to worry about them having one in Bayview Park. That's not a person nowhere that would go to Bayview Park and see that big cross and think anything about God or Christ. Understanding of the cross, all this stuff you got with your gold and all this stuff with cross, I don't think none of that represent the cross that Jesus died on. But the book said it was an old rugged cross. It was something that had been to the plain on there. It hadn't been smoothed out. It hadn't been laid. It was an old rugged cross. And if your thoughts about the cross don't cause you to want to live for God, gotten so caught up in religion, man's laws and man's rules and regulations, until we have ignored what God requires. Five, the Bible said when Peter was preaching on the day of Pentecost, and he began to tell them how they crucified the Savior and hung him on the tree. But God raised him from the dead. The Bible said they were pricked in their hearts. And they cried out, men and brethren, what must we do? And he said, repent, every one of you. And be baptized for the remission of your sins. And receive ye the Holy Ghost. And now, folk who have turned around and made it say what they wanted to say. You understand? You got folk now talking about it. You don't speak in tongues. then you're not saved.
Yes, Lord.
And they keep trying to make it be something that is subjective. And the problem with that is when you say you gotta do something to prove yourself, it's always somebody who can do it good enough to make you think they got something. You always say that. But just as soon find out that they don't have nothing. You understand? I was raised in the Pentecostal church. And they have taught folk, and if you ever in service with them, when they get up and speak, they always, before they stand up long, got to tell you, I think God has said, sanctified, and you have the Holy Ghost with fire, and be baptized, and you understand. And let me tell you something about the Spirit of God. If you got it, you don't have to tell nobody that got it. Amen. You understand? It's like me saying, I'm a man, I got this beard right here around my face.
Oh, Lord. That's right.
Amen.
If you got it, you don't have to tell nobody you got it.
Right, still right. Yourself.
The tree is known by the fruit it bears.
Yeah.
I don't care what you say you are.
Yeah.
There's no evidence or no fruit for what you say that you are.
Right.
I just don't believe you got it.
Thank you. Thank you.
As such, the Bible says, when Paul got to Ephesus.
Yes, thank you.
There he found 12 men who were disciples of Jonah.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. I don't fault these men because the Bible said from all that they had been told, they had done what they were told.
Amen.
But Paul asked them a question and saying, have you receive the Holy Ghost since you believed. That's an important and significant question. Because I know a lot of folk who have confessed Christ, who have been baptized, who have said that they're on the road for God. And as time go by, it becomes more and more apparent. That all they received was baptism. But God wants to do more for you. In fact, what you're trying to do on your own is what God sent the Holy Ghost to enable you to do.
All right.
You understand that? So you wanna do what God's will is. But you're trying to do it without what God gave you to help you to do it with. You know what I'm saying? You know, we got a film here Friday for a little baby.
Yes.
And they had a casket out, and the casket had the wheels under the roller, what they typically take with grown folk. And when the recession was going, the undertaker took the casket off of the rolling wheels and then walked back toting the casket in his hand. And I reckon because it was a little baby, he found that to be easy. Y'all ain't saying that, but just envision if somebody fat as me had died. And instead of trying to roll me out, he tried to pick me up and pull me out. And I'm just saying that because this is what some of us are trying. We're trying to live a life that's pleasing to God. God has given us something with wheels on it. God has given us something that would lighten the load. God has given us what we need to help us to do what He wants us to do. And we're trying to turn off the coast.
All right. Amen. Amen.
He said, have you received? And interesting enough that he met them and they presented themselves as disciples.
Yeah.
That same things about the Holy Ghost that we see as signs.
Yeah.
And in a modern church, there are folk who think that the only sign is that if you speak in tongues.
Yes.
And folk have made a mockery out of speaking in tongues.
Yeah.
You understand that nobody in the scripture was saying pineapple pie, papa pie. Nobody was saying he's turning on a Honda, even on a Cadillac. Nobody was saying, nobody was just babbling words, but speaking in tongues. They were speaking in languages that they had not studied or learned, but the people who heard them in their language. Should we wake up like it does something to make us look stupid or do stupid things, but this was something very intelligent. The book said when the day of Pentecost was fully come, that is, there were men from every nation who typically would come to the feast and could only enjoy a certain portion. Because there were different languages spoken by the many different people who were at the feast. But God, Jesus, told his disciples that wait for them in the upper room. You're going to be endowed with power for all. After that, the Holy Ghost is going to come. And he said, you're going to be witnesses unto me in Judea and in Samaria and in the utmost parts of the earth. Now in Judea and Samaria, it would have been easy because perhaps they all could understand the Galilean language. But when he says in the utmost parts of the earth, how in the world can I preach this people in Russia and I can't speak Russian and they don't understand English? He said, you're going to be witnesses. That was his promise. So instead of giving them something all one at a time, all up for the church to catch fire. The best timing was on the day of Pentecost. Send out men from every nation. The Bible says when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one place with one mind or with one accord. You know, everybody was there expecting the presence of God. Nobody was there to show off their new suit. Nobody was there to get somebody told. But they were all there with one accord. Expecting to receive something from the presence of God. The Bible said that suddenly there came, this is Acts the second chapter, there came a sound from heaven. As of a rushing and mighty wind. And it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it sat upon each of them, and they spake in tongues as the Spirit of God gave utterance. Now you got to understand how this went. But all these disciples were all there who spoke the same language. But in the audience there was a language barrier because there were folk who could not understand their language. But since God had made a promise, and this is what I like about God's promises, since God had made a promise that they would be witnesses in all the world, it had to start somewhere. So as the Spirit moved in the house, it caused them to speak. And while they spake, there were men that could hear them in their own language. Can't you imagine what a miracle this was for somebody who needed some good news? Can you imagine how this must have felt to see somebody speak in one way and then speak another way? Isn't it good when we get away from all this foolishness, all this high-five your neighbor and tell your neighbor stuff? When we get somebody who can speak to our condition, ain't it something when we hear to being stuck on themselves. They never mention the love of God. Some places they might as well be speaking a foreign language. You come in burning down and you leave out burning down. You come in with problems and you leave with even more problems. But when the Lord speaks, when the Lord speaks, somebody is to say or think that God is so unintelligent until he would waste our time with somebody blabbing on something and nobody knows what they're saying. If my child is in trouble, I don't want you speaking a foreign language. If I'm hurting in my body, I don't want you talking about something that I can't understand. But God salvation, yes, to simply sing, yes, if you would just speak in tongues, yes. So they got the bright idea, yes, that we'll just keep saying Jesus, yes, Jesus, Jesus, yes, Jesus, and we gonna say it, uh-huh, until you get the Holy Ghost, yes. Well, if you keep on doing folk like that, yes, just so you'll let them get up, uh-huh, just so something, but still didn't get what God wanted them to have. See, the Holy Ghost is not something you gotta beg for. It's not something you gotta keep calling for. But when you ask him and you believe, he'll put it in your heart. Some folks, I ain't mocking, but some folks didn't get it that way. But that's because their faith was right. That's because they wanted it at that point. Desire, but you don't have to do that. God can speak and put it on your heart. You can be in your automobile and God can shine down. He can get it to you while the choir's singing. Whenever your faith lines up with God, he will.
Amen.
So these men, in Ephesus, had heard the word, and these men were baptized, but not with the Holy Ghost. Now, yes, church, know for sure what Paul's evidence was, but it was apparent to him that it didn't go far enough. Yeah, it was apparent to him that they had not done everything that John had told them. Did not John say, I'm baptized with water, but one is coming after me? So you know you needed his baptism. You ought to be looking for the one who's coming after him. Don't be satisfied with just sitting in the chair. Don't be when I'm in trouble. confusion. Give me something that'll give me love when I'm used to hate. He's able, and I know he will. Oh, he will. You gotta ask him for it. You gotta believe and trust in the Lord. But they had not received the Holy Ghost. It could have been because they couldn't do no miracles. Or it could have been because they didn't have love for one another. It is something when folk in the world got more love for one another than folk in the church. It is something how when we come in here with God as the object of worship, when we come in God's house, look on one side of the church and see folk we just can't sit by. See folk that we just can't be in church with. Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? How do I know why some folk don't want it?
All right.
You understand that?
Yes.
When folk do all kind of foolishness in church and then blame it on the Spirit.
Yeah.
It was the Spirit, all right, but it wasn't the Holy Spirit.
All right.
Crazy stuff and blame it on the Holy Ghost. It was a ghost, all right, but it wasn't the Holy Ghost. You understand, shaking and running and convulsing and all kinds of that. God is a spirit.
All right.
He's a gentle spirit.
Amen.
Yeah. God, you talk of praising and to come to church, and I got something that's going to make you not be able to keep this and make you fall out. That's the goal.
Yes.
Let me lay hands on you, make you fall out. Now you can drink enough and fall out.
Right.
At least you enjoyed the high. But I just don't come in here and you don't just knock me out.
Amen.
And say that's the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Now he said, thief come but for the steal, to kill, and destroy.
Yes.
But I come that to have life.
Yeah.
He don't have to knock you out to give you life. He said that you might have it more abundantly.
Yes.
You understand? You come in talking about the Holy Ghost got you on such a high. You all this and you all that. You're shouting all over the place. And Monday morning, your head hung down in sorrow. The Holy It's not just something that you turn on when you get to church. You understand? I reckon that's why some folk don't want it. Because your Holy Ghost work good at church, but it don't work nowhere else. I know why some people don't want it. Because the folk who say they got it, it's a problem with how they conduct themselves. God is a spirit.
Yeah.
They that worship him must worship him in spirit and